Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs. Gildan Media presents an unabridged recording of The Mind-Body Problem by Jonathan Westphal, narrated by Sean Pratt. Series Forward. The MIT Press Essential Knowledge Series offers accessible, concise, beautifully produced pocket-sized books on topics of current interest. Written by leading thinkers, the books in this series deliver expert overviews of subjects that range from the cultural and the historical to the scientific and the technical. In today's era of instant information gratification, we have ready access to opinions, rationalizations, and superficial descriptions. Much harder to come by is the foundational knowledge that informs a principled understanding of the world. Essential knowledge books fill that need. Synthesizing specialized subject matter for non-specialists and engaging critical topics through fundamentals, each of these compact volumes offers listeners and readers a point of access to complex ideas. Bruce Titer, Professor of Biological Engineering and Computer Science, Massachusetts Institute of Technology. Preface. The mind-body problem is a paradox. A paradox is a group of propositions for each of which we have apparently sound arguments, yet the propositions taken together are inconsistent. We cannot affirm all the propositions in the group, yet we have good reason to believe that they are all true. My approach is a narrower one than is usually taken to the mind-body problem, but I believe that this approach can help us to think clearly about what is going on with the particular solutions that have been given to the problem in the past. It will help us not to get lost in the metaphysics of things other than the mind and the body. The mind-body problem, in its full generality, which I introduce in Chapter 1, is about the mind and the body, not about the self or consciousness or the soul or anything other than the mind and body. In Chapter 5, however, I do consider some important scientific theories of consciousness as examples of scientific treatments of this part of the mind and the mind-body problem. Consciousness, the study of which has recently become important in the cognitive sciences, can reasonably be regarded as a part of the mind, though it is not the whole of it, nor is it, as Descartes believed, the essence of mind. Among other questions, the mind-body problem can be taken to raise the issue of the physicality of the mind. It's certainly hard to see how it can be true that the mind, and with it consciousness, is just physical matter. We cannot watch or even imagine the neurons firing and emitting little bursts of mentality or consciousness, like diaphanous fairies flitting around the brain. The brain is ostensibly physical, indeed material, weighing in at a hefty 3 pounds or so, but it doesn't make sense even to ask how much the mind weighs. One can say that the human brain is approximately 2% of the weight of the human being, and one can say that it contains 100 million neurons, not to mention glial cells. But these things are not true of the human mind. We can say that the brain measures roughly 5 by 6 by 4 inches. Nothing remotely like that can be said of the mind. Of course, there are more sophisticated versions of materialism, the thesis that everything that exists is something material, or physicalism, the thesis that everything that exists is something physical, which I discuss in Chapter 3, but the same difficulty remains buried in all of them. Following David Chalmers, philosophers and others have wanted to distinguish the hard problem from the easy problem of consciousness, or rather, the easy problems. There are many, according to Chalmers, and quite a lot has been written about this recently. By the easy problems, Chalmers means the problems of describing the physical processes by which we come to have, for example, the consciousness of whiteness, assuming that we can make sense of this phrase. Clearly, there are many problems of this sort. We have to understand the mechanisms of the eyes, of the ears, of touch, of the nose, and so on. The hard problem is to understand how our experience of whiteness, and with it our consciousness of whiteness, could arise from the pure physical systems operating in the visual cortex. The idea is that we can understand experience by the physical processes that go on when we perceive, but that there are properties of the experiences that cannot be understood in this way. These are the qualia, and for Chalmers, they are not physical. Fair enough, but this new 20th century hard problem is simply a souped-up version of an old problem which, as we shall see in Chapter 1, appeared with Descartes and his critics in 1641. The hard problem is hard. Why? Because it is the mind-body problem, and that is a hard problem. Chalmers' hard problem of consciousness is just the mind-body problem with a new name, complete with a very sharp distinction between the more easily understood physical processes and consciousness or qualia or mind. For Descartes, the principal attribute of the mind is consciousness, and so, as his critics pointed out, there is a problem about the relation of the mind to the body. This is all down to the difficulty of asserting that the mind is physical. The mind does not seem to fit into the world of physics and physiology at all, or so claims dualism. I consider different forms of dualism in Chapter 2. In the mid-17th century, the mind-body problem became a central problem. The world not, as it is often said that Schopenhauer called it. He didn't. What Schopenhauer would perhaps have meant, had he used that phrase for the mind-body problem, is that the problem signifies that our day-to-day concepts of the mental and the physical and the mind and the body are somehow tangled up in such a way that our entire conception of the world, including the physical world, is called into question by the mind-body problem. The metaphysical problem itself has only gained in significance since philosophers first became aware of it, and at the end of the 20th century and the beginning of the 21st, for better or for worse, it is still alive and well. My own view, presented in chapters 6 and 7, is friendly toward antimaterialist arguments. It is also friendly to dualism, the view that there are two distinct kinds of things in the world, not just one. I have been thinking about the mind-body problem since I first encountered it as a student. At that time, the atmosphere in American and English universities was strongly physicalist or materialist in orientation. It is hard to recapture a sense of how strong that atmosphere was and the way in which students who held other views felt intimidated and sidelined. I imagine that it would be very difficult now to give an historically true account of how these students moved into disciplines outside philosophy, disciplines that for them had more of a feeling for what kind of thing the mind and even the human being might be, and of what the possibilities of philosophy were. Fortunately, philosophy today is becoming more welcoming to the outsider, as it should be, not just because of a corrective politics, but because philosophy itself has realized that it fundamentally mistakes its mission if it is unwelcoming to the intellectual stranger, the outsider. I was one of those sidelined students. For me, at that time, the powerful contemporary materialism was a problem. I started in freshman year with 17th century philosophy, especially Leibniz, under Professor Edwin Curley, and I felt immediately at home there. I was convinced, however, and I still am, that a really determined and sustained analysis of a philosophical view, coupled with a sense of responsibility to the language in which it is expressed, will end up arriving, at the very least, at the problems faced by that view, and at the most, at a definite knowledge about whether the view is true or false. I have read and heard nothing since I was a student that has made me doubt this conviction. Materialism might have been true. Since the 1960s, it has suffered something of a decline, and several significant new anti-materialist arguments have appeared in the philosophy of mind. Chapter 4 is about these arguments. It is interesting and surprising that the new developments have taken place just as philosophy and science are becoming friendlier toward one another. It is even more interesting that these arguments have hardly disturbed the default materialist and naturalist convictions of the bulk of scientists and philosophers today. Naturalism is the view that nature is all there is, so that all occurrences are natural occurrences. Where do these materialist and naturalist convictions come from, if not from reason? Reason can, of course, take many forms, and one of them is the merely pedestrian or labored intellect. Whatever view we take of the current situation, the time seems favorable to a study of the whole problem. This means more than fussing with debates about the details of the theories that have been offered for the solution of the problem. The problem is not about debates, and philosophy generally is not debate. What we need is an understanding of the structure of the problem and of its origins in the concepts of the mind, the body, the physical, and the mental. Why another book on the mind-body problem? Why now? The answer is that this is not another book on the mind-body problem. There has been no full-length and comprehensive book devoted to the problem for a very long time indeed. I believe that this may be partly to do with the fact that a materialist orientation is still the most natural one for many philosophers. From that point of view, the mind-body problem really is impossibly hard. For me, that is yet another reason not to be a materialist, and instead to look more carefully at forgotten or overlooked views in the history of the subject, as I do in the last two chapters of the present book, arguing for my own view, which is neutral monism, in chapter 7. I am particularly interested in the fact that neutral monists in the past have not given enough attention, if any, to mind-body interaction, nor have they actually stated a solution to the mind-body problem, contenting themselves instead with enthusiasm about the oneness of things. I have offered some suggestions about how to remedy this, and an analysis of how the neutral monist ought to understand mind-body interaction. Chapter 1. The Mind-Body Problem. Background and History. What is the mind-body problem? From a logical point of view, the mind-body problem is easy to understand, and it can be expressed clearly in just four propositions or statements. The following formulation is one I have adapted from Keith Campbell. 1. The mind is a non-physical thing. 2. The body is a physical thing. 3. The mind and the body interact. And 4. Physical and non-physical things cannot interact. It's very hard to deny any of these four propositions, but they cannot consistently be held to be true together. At least one of them must be false, and the attempt to show the exact way in which this plays out is the work of developing a solution to the mind-body problem. As I just formulated, the mind-body problem is an entirely logical problem. The four propositions simply cannot consistently be maintained together. Nothing can change that. There really is a contradiction to be derived from them. And the problem is the tension between the propositions. Of course, it's also possible to maintain vague propositions very similar to all four propositions, but which do not have the hard and fast relationships that are suggested by the formal terms in which the inconsistent group is stated. If we were to take the four terms, mind, body, physical, and non-physical, and how they are related in the four propositions in such a way as to produce an inconsistency, we would come up with a series of terms that would just revolve around and around on each other. The mind interacts with the body. The body is a physical thing. A physical thing cannot interact with a non-physical thing. And finally, a non-physical thing is the mind, which starts the whole thing over again. The point of putting the problem in this rather formal way is that the four propositions are what philosophers and logicians sometimes call an inconsistent tetrad. What this phrase means is that of the four propositions, the tetrad, any three can be true at the same time. But if they are, then the fourth is false. Here is the inconsistency. For example, if 1, 2, and 3 are true, then 4 is false. If the mind is a non-physical thing, and the body is a physical thing, and the mind and body interact, then it follows that at least one non-physical thing and one physical thing do, in fact, interact. And so it is false that physical and non-physical things cannot interact, and the fourth proposition is false. Or suppose the last three propositions, numbers 2, 3, and 4, are true. Suppose that physical and non-physical things cannot interact, that mind and body do interact, and that the body is a physical thing. Then it follows that the mind is not a non-physical thing, which is to say that the mind is a physical thing. The mind must be a physical thing because the body is a physical thing and it interacts with the mind. But physical and non-physical things, we assumed, cannot interact, so number 1 must be false. It is fun to play around with the four original propositions, 1 through 4, in this way, choosing any three, and then deriving the opposite or negation of the fourth. By doing this, one can get a good sense of how the mind-body problem is a logical problem. It's a problem that cannot be solved, if by solving it one means holding on to all four propositions at once. When one has seen that holding on to all four propositions is not a logical option, one can see clearly that the first and most basic question is which one of the four propositions one is going to deny. We can also describe the mind-body problem in less formal terms. Consider the human body with everything in it, including internal and external organs and parts, such as the stomach, nerves and brain, arms, legs, eyes, and all the rest. Even with all this equipment, especially the sensory organs, it is interesting and surprising that we can consciously perceive things in the world that are far away from us. For example, I can open my eyes in the morning and see a nice cup of coffee waiting for me on the bedside table. There it is, a foot away, and I am not touching it. Yet somehow, it is making itself manifest to me. How does it happen that I see it? How does the visual system convey to my awareness or mind the image of the cup of coffee? The answer is not particularly simple. Very roughly, the physical story is that light enters my eyes from the cup of coffee, and this light impinges on the two retinas at the backs of my eyes. Then, as we have learned from physiological science, the two retinas send electrical signals past the optic chasm down the optic nerve. These signals are conveyed to the so-called visual cortex at the back of the brain, and then there is a sort of a miracle. The visual cortex becomes active and I see the coffee cup. I am conscious of the cup, we might even say. Though it's not clear what this means and how it differs from saying that I see the cup. How did the physical state of the brain produce in me the exciting awareness of the presence of the cup of coffee? One minute there were just neurons firing away and no image of the cup of coffee. The next, there it is. I see the cup of coffee a foot away. I am not aware of all those neurons firing, and I certainly don't see them. The neurosurgeon is the one who sees them. What I see is a cup of coffee. How did my neurons contact me, or my mind or consciousness, and stamp there the image of the cup of coffee for me? How did the sensation of a cup of coffee arise from the mass of neurons? It's a mystery. That mystery is the mind-body problem, or part of it. We want to divide the problem up this way. Let us call the visual experience the mental state that in this case contains the image of the cup of coffee. The mental state is related in some way, still to be determined, to whatever is going on objectively and physically when we see the cup. In addition to these two sets of events, the mental experience and the physical events that underlie it, there is said to be the subjective character of what is seen. This subjective character is something for which some philosophers have adopted the phrase, what it is like, as in the phrase, what it is like to have the experience of seeing a cup. What it is like to have the experience of seeing a cup is to be identified with the consciousness of seeing a cup. To be conscious of the cup is for there to be something it is like to have that experience. The phrase originates with the philosopher Timothy Sprigg and was also used later and made popular by Thomas Nagel. It's intended to capture this extra bit of what experience involves. What is it like to see a cup of coffee? Or, in more general terms, what is it like to be a conscious human being? Compare this with the question of what it is like to be a stone. Well, there is nothing it is like to be a stone. So, by the criterion of Sprig and Nagel, the stone has no consciousness. This what it is like has also received from philosophers and others the name qualia, a Latin word, and also the Latin word qualia. When I see or otherwise perceive a cup of coffee, I am aware of the qualia that attaches to the experience, and which is presumably altogether absent from a video feed carrying the same information. Video displays do not have consciousness. For consciousness to come into the picture, someone has to be looking at the video picture. The idea of the qualia is unfortunately not altogether clear. Some philosophers have used the term to refer not to properties of experiences, such as the white cup shape that I see when I see the cup, as I have outlined their role previously, but to the experiences themselves. There is a genuine ambiguity here, and the two philosophical usages are inconsistent. If qualia are experiences, then they themselves are properties of the subjects who have them, and they are psychological entities. If they are properties of experiences, then they are not properties of the subjects who have the experiences. They are independent, metaphysical entities. For example, the color white and the shape of the cup, which somehow turn up in the subject's minds. There is also the question whether when I see a white cup, I have one qualia or many. Do I have one white cup qualia? Or many smaller white-colored cup qualia that together make up the whole cup image? Neither answer is satisfactory. How many qualia do I have when I look at a speckled hen, to take a famous example? I cannot see how many spots or speckles there are, especially if the hen is running about with its head bobbing, and there may not even be a definite number. Or how many different qualia do I have when I look at a quality changing smoothly over time, say, the reds across the spectrum? The point is that the same difficulty does not attack concepts like a color or being colored, for example, in the claim that the bread is brown in color, even though specks of it are white, say, or gray. Color and being colored are more tolerant concepts than the qualia. I shall use the words qualia and qualia when the context or the author I am discussing calls for them, and phenomenal property when the emphasis is more on the quality that is the object of experience. I regret to say that the history of the terminology is sufficiently confused to allocate such latitude. The term qualia has an interesting and, one might say, checkered history. In the past, the phrases and words cogitationes, ideas, experiences, sense data, qualities, perceptions, sensations, properties of sensations, percepts, raw feels, nomological danglers, phenomenal properties, and qualitative properties have been used to try to get at something approximately like the same idea. The confused history of the different terminologies is enough to alert the thoughtful student of recent philosophy to the fact that all is not as it should be in the kingdom of the qualia. Why the frequent changes in terminology and the zigzag of complicated arguments to try to get across what ought to be a fairly straightforward idea or set of ideas? There is a well-known story about Herbert Feigl giving a lecture about the mind and the brain at UCLA in 1966, in which he discussed a part of the problem of the relation of mind and brain to which he simply couldn't see the solution, in spite of his materialism, namely, the problem of raw feels. The distinguished philosopher Rudolf Carnap was in the audience, and he announced in the Q&A that he had a solution to the problem of raw feels. Feigl was excited and asked what it was. "The solution to your problem, Herbert," replied Carnap, "is the alpha factor." Feigl got even more excited and wanted to know what the alpha factor was, as, in spite of his scientific education, the concept was new to him. Well, Herbert, you tell me what a raw feel is, and I'll tell you what the alpha factor is, Carnap responded. It was a fair point. The conceptual and linguistic difficulties of describing qualia, or phenomenal properties, are formidable enough. Yet it remains a fact that though a scientist can take a scan of my brain, say, recording my blood flowing or my neurons firing, there is no equivalent scan for my experiences. There do seem to be two different worlds here that are related, but how are they related? It is also important to be aware that the mind-body problem is about the relationship between the human mind and the human physical body. It is also about the relationship between animal minds, if there are any, and animal bodies, but in this book I will restrict discussion to the human case. The relationship between mind and body exists with or without qualia. If I am in the mental state involved in unconsciously seeing a cup of coffee or unconsciously thinking about a problem, one might very well wonder how that mental state is related to the physical body, even if no qualia attached to it. It's easier to see what the problem is if we consider the mind-body problem going in the opposite direction. Consider the body again. There are my arms, outside the blankets, and I reach out with my right hand and take hold of my cup of coffee because I want to have a sip of coffee. How did I do that? How did my mental desire for a sip of coffee get my physical arm to reach out to the cup? Well, we know the answer, at least partly. My muscles moved my arm. But how did my mental desire move my physical muscles? Did my mind somehow reach into my arm and move the muscles? Again, we know the answer, or think we do. Electrical signals from the brain moved the muscles, not mental energy directed at them. Yet the question persists. How did my mental desire cause the physical electrical signals to start up and then to run down my arms and move the muscles? Again, physiology provides an answer. It was not my mind, the mental, that produced the physical electrical signals, but the neurons firing in my brain. All right, but now we get to the nerve of the problem, so to speak. How did my mental desire, carrying its associated qualia along with it, cause my physical neurons to fire? We seem to have some form of telekinesis here, the moving of objects by mental energy alone. If the response is that it is other neurons, rather than my mental want that caused the neurons to fire, then the question has been avoided, rather than answered. How does my mental desire cause those other neurons to fire? There might be no qualia associated with this desire, or there might be an unconscious mental desire. But the question remains of how it causes the neurons to fire and to initiate the moving of my arm. So qualia are part of the mind-body problem, but the problem also involves any relationship between the mind and the body, including unconscious states of mind and physical states. Matter or the physical can somehow affect the mind, and the mind can somehow move the physical body. These somehows are difficult to understand, though, because we cannot see either how there could be aspects of mental experience or qualia floating around amid the neurons, or desires trailing clouds of their attendant qualia, physically digging into the neurons and making them fire. Descartes and the discovery of the problem in 1641. There is a very common view which states that, in his book titled The Meditations on First Philosophy, of 1641, and also in his book, The Treatise on Man, written some years earlier, the French philosopher René Descartes discovered, or invented, the problem that today we call the mind-body problem. Our mind-body problem is not just a difficulty about how the mind and body are related and how they affect one another. It's also a difficulty about how they can be related and how they can affect one another. Their characteristic properties are very different, like oil and water, which simply won't mix, given what they are. According to Descartes, matter is essentially spatial, and it has the characteristic properties of linear dimension. Things in space have a position, at least, and a height, a depth, and a length, or one or more of these. Areas are two-dimensional, and lines are one-dimensional, but both have a place in space. Objects are three-dimensional, apparently, at least in ordinary experience. Mental entities, on the other hand, do not have these characteristics. We cannot say of the mind or any part of it that it is a 2x2x2-inch cube, or a sphere with a 2-inch radius, for example, located in a position in space inside the skull. This is not because it has some other shape in space, but because it is not characterized by space at all. What is characteristic of a mind, Descartes claims, is that it is conscious, not that it has shape or consists of physical matter. Unlike the brain, which has physical characteristics and occupies space, it does not seem to make sense to attach spatial descriptions to the mind. We can ask, how much space does the mind occupy? Or, what shape is it? Or, is it three-dimensional or two-dimensional? Or, where is it in physical space? But these questions have no answers, as the questions make no sense. There is no need to claim, as Descartes did, that the essence of the physical is space. We need merely that something's being in space is a necessary condition for its being physical at all. It is interesting that this straightforward test of physicality has survived all the philosophical changes of opinion since Descartes, almost unscathed. Even some strange entity in physics that is said not to be in space does not automatically count as a counterexample, for there is nothing to prevent us from saying that, with such entities, physics is dealing with something nonphysical. Nonphysical just because it does not have a position in space. And, typically, entities that are said not to have a position in space are more the creatures of mathematics than of physics. To drive this point home, we should ponder Noam Chomsky's celebrated view that we do not even know what the mind-body problem is because we don't have a clear concept of the physical or of body. He wrote, "Lacking a concept of matter or body or the physical, we have no coherent way to formulate issues related to the mind-body problem. But we do have a concept of space laid out before us, and of physics as dealing with whatever it contains. Our bodies are certainly in space, and our minds are not, in the very straightforward sense that the assignation of linear dimensions and locations to them, or to their contents and activities, is unintelligible." Such issues aroused considerable interest following the publication of Descartes' Meditations, starting with the Objections to Descartes. The Objections were written by a group of distinguished contemporaries, and in return, Descartes wrote his Replies. The Objections and Replies were included in the first edition of the Meditations. Though we do find in the Meditations itself the distinction, the real distinction between the mind and the body, drawn very sharply by Descartes. In fact, he makes no mention of our mind-body problem. Descartes is untroubled by the fact that, as he has described them, mind and matter are very different. One is spatial and the other not, and therefore one cannot act upon the other. Something lacking a position in space cannot act upon something in space, say, at a point. The problem is simply not there in his text. Descartes himself writes in his reply to one of the objections, "The whole problem contained in such questions arises simply from a supposition that is false and cannot in any way be proved, namely that if the soul and the body are two substances whose nature is different, this prevents them from being able to act on each other." Descartes is surely right about this. The nature of a baked Alaska pudding is very different from that of a human being, no doubt about this at all, since one is a pudding and the other is a human being, but the two can act on each other without difficulty. The human being can eat the baked Alaska pudding, for example, and the baked Alaska can give the human being a stomachache. The difficulty, however, is not merely that mind and body are different. It is that they are different in such a way that their interaction is impossible.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.